Throughout human history, artists have relied on lines to simplify images, allowing them to focus on the most important elements and communicate their ideas clearly. Line drawings have played a crucial role in storytelling. By the late 19th century, comic strips had gained significant popularity. Eventually, comics would be a major inspiration for animation. The simplicity of line work not only made animation possible, but also added a rich dimension of expression. In early video games, pixel art outlines were crucial. They helped players instantly recognize what they were looking at. As the medium evolved, their visual style drew inspiration from the aesthetics of feature animation. And now, with the rise of modern 3D pipelines, many games deliberately adopt outlines with cell shading or dithering effects to create distinct visual styles. In our video on dithering, we mentioned that using outlines can help make it easier to see what is happening in a dithered scene, as it has been done in The Return of the Obradin. And whether it's highlighting interactive elements or framing important information, outlines remain fundamental to game UI design. But here's the thing, although using outlines is usually straightforward and simple in most traditional art, rendering them in 3D graphics is surprisingly challenging. Getting them to look just right takes a lot of work and requires some clever technical solutions. In this video, we dive into key techniques for rendering outlines on 3D objects using shaders. When we're done, you will understand the basic algorithms and know what to watch out for when you implement them. Hi there, I'm Arman from GameLogicFX. If you're a game developer, you know how game effects can make or break the magic of games. You probably spend more time than you care to admit experimenting with shaders, particles, and other tricks to get things just right. Here on this channel, we dive into the art and science of game effects. We'll revisit classic techniques that still shine in modern games and uncover innovative methods to give your projects that next level feel. So if you're ready to level up your effects, go ahead and hit subscribe and that notification bell. We've got some incredible content lined up. What makes rendering outlines difficult? Let's think about it for a second. In the real world, lines don't actually exist. What we interpret as lines are really our brain's way of processing sudden changes in light, color, or depth, and our understanding of the shapes of objects. Before we jump in, let's break down various different types of lines that we might encounter. Boundary lines are the lines on the edges of meshes, such as the edges of a paper. Silhouette lines define the edges that separate an object from the background. Crease lines form where two triangles meet at an angle. Think of the edges of a cube. Contour lines appear where two triangles face in different directions, for example, the handle of a cup, the part that is not a silhouette or a crease line. Material lines emerge where two triangles with different materials meet, such as a window in a wall or a car light. Color or value lines are edges that show up where there's a sharp change in brightness or color, like the edge of a shadow. Contour and silhouette lines shift as you move the camera around. Color and value edges depend on lighting, and therefore may also be affected by the camera's orientation or by shadows. But boundary, crease, and material lines stay fixed in place, unless you are animating the object itself. One important detail to note is that, except for color and value lines, all these lines correspond to the edges of triangles in our 3D mesh. While we don't cover purely geometric approaches in this video, those all build on this fundamental principle. Let's start with one of the simplest techniques, using rim shaders. This method detects contour and silhouette edges by comparing the normal of each fragment with the viewing direction. When the angle between them is nearly perpendicular, we render our outline color. Rim shading shines when working with smooth organic shapes, and it's fairly easy to implement. This is how it looks in our sample scene. But there are some important quirks to consider. It highlights any flat surfaces that are close to perpendicular to your view, and it omits edges between other flat surfaces. So how do we refine this to make it look right? One key insight is that flat and rounded surfaces behave differently. Edges of flat surfaces stay put, regardless of viewing angle. But on rounded surfaces, edges shift as you rotate the object. This means that we could optimize our approach, using vertex or texture information, to mark edges on flat surfaces, and rendering them using that information, while using the technique just described to handle the rounded surfaces. In our video on dithering, we mentioned that rendering your outlines can help to make dithered scenes more readable, especially when the color palette is limited. That's where rim shaders come in. The same idea can be used to make fur look nicer, usually by making a lighter outline. Now for another powerful technique, a double pass method, rendering the mesh twice. First, render a slightly bigger version of the mesh in the outline color. And second, render the original version in its normal colors and materials. This works by rendering the inside of the mesh instead of the outside in the first pass, culling the front faces of the object, and rendering the back faces behind the object. But how do we control the expansion to get the bigger version of the mesh? We have two simple strategies for moving vertices. Push them outward from the object center, or push them in the direction of the vertex normals. For more complex meshes, we may want to supply custom directions or do more sophisticated calculations, but the two simple strategies work well in many cases. For static meshes, we can pre-calculate the direction and store them in vertex colors. Better yet, if the object's pivot point sits at its center, we can compute the extrusion direction right in the shader. One thing that we need to watch out for: the outline thickness will be proportional to the distance of the object to the camera. In other words, the further away the object is, the thinner its outlines will appear. If this is not what we want, we can extrude the object in clip space. This works fairly well, but it can still result in lines that are not all equally thick everywhere because of the viewing angles. This method does not work with boundary edges. To work around this limitation, we need to turn boundary edges into crease edges by duplicating and flipping the relevant triangles. Now let's explore how to detect edges directly in our rendered image. The classic approach starts by taking two versions of our image. Both are blurred using a box or Gaussian blur, but the one is blurred more than the other. When we subtract one from the other and apply a threshold to the result, the edges pop right out. We then comb this together over our original render. Blurring an image is straightforward. A box blur simply averages the colors in a square around each pixel. This square is called a window. The basic naive code for this is very simple, but it comes with a performance catch. It's quadratic in terms of the window width, meaning it gets slow rapidly as our window width grows. The window width determines the width of our line, so this performance cost really hits us for wider lines. We can do much better if we do it in two passes. First, we blur the image vertically, then horizontally. This algorithm makes our processing time grow linearly with the window size. We call operations that can be split into the horizontal and vertical components separable. Here is the result in our scene. Gaussian blur works on a similar principle to box blur, but with a twist. Instead of treating all neighboring pixels equally, the technique weights them based on their distance from the center pixel. The closer, the bigger the weight. Gaussian blurs are also separable, so we can get the same benefit of processing the time proportional to the window width. Blurring is such an important fundamental component of many effects that we'll dedicate an entire video to exploring it more thoroughly. There's one more way to detect edges in the scene. Instead of blurring the image, averaging pixels in our window, we can dilate it by taking the maximum value of the pixels in the window. The maximum operation works independently on each color channel. For a given pixel, we take its red value from the highest red value in our window, its green value from the highest green value, and its blue value from the highest blue value. When working with square regions for the maximum filters, we can also split the operation just like the blur passes we looked at earlier. This gives us the same performance benefits as with a Gaussian or box blur. Here is the intermediate step after the first pass. And here is the final result. And here is what we get if we use this to create outlines. Let's explore some direct filtering approaches. These techniques detect edges, usually in two passes, but this time the edges appear directly, instead of creating an intermediate image that is compared with the original. The simplest filter is called Robert's cross operator. It examines only 4 pixels, but can give surprisingly good results. A more sophisticated filter, the Sobel operator, examines 9 pixels for even better edge detection. We're not limited to working with the color of our objects. Instead of blurring or dilating the regular color image, we can apply these same techniques, namely difference of blurs or difference of max values, to other properties, such as the depth, normals, or object IDs that we can render to buffers. Combining all three properties makes our edge detection significantly more robust. What about really thick outlines? Even our separable filter techniques are too slow for those. Luckily, this is where the even faster jump fill algorithm shines. It's a clever technique that runs in logarithmic time relative to the line width. It's worth taking the time to understand it because it takes advantage of the parallelism of GPU shaders, and its structure can be used to construct other parallel algorithms too. So let's take a look. The jump fill algorithm has 4 elegant stages. First, we render the object's silhouette. Next, we render the UV coordinates for relevant pixels. Then comes the core of the algorithm. For each pixel, we calculate and render the coordinates of the closest edge pixel. Finally, for each pixel, We calculate whether its closest edge pixel is within the outline width or not, and then we render either the original image or the outline accordingly. Here's a closer look. To simplify the explanation, suppose our object has only one pixel and our screen is 5x5 pixels. Well, what we want to construct is a mapping from each pixel in the image to the closest pixel in our object. Since we have only one pixel in the object, all pixels on screen will be mapped to it. We can use this mapping to draw outlines by checking if each pixel is within the outline using this test. We calculate the distance between a pixel and the pixel it is mapped to, and if the distance is smaller than the line width, the pixel is considered part of the outline. For the final outline, we would discard pixels that fall inside the object, but we will ignore this detail for now. If we use a width of 0, we only get the pixels that are inside the object. Let's try it out with a few pixels in the image. The top left pixel is 0,0. It is mapped to 0.5, 0.5. The distance between these is 0.707. This is bigger than 0, so the test fails. The pixel to the right of our object also fails the test. The pixel in the center is 0.5, 0.5. It is mapped to itself, 0.5, 0.5, so the distance to it is 0. This passes the test, and this pixel is within the outline. In fact, this is the only pixel within the outline. Since it is also in the object, we discard it, so the final outline will have no pixels, as is desired. Let's try it now with a width of a pixel, which is 0.25. The distances we calculated before don't change, so we can reuse them. The top left pixel still fails the test, but this time the pixel to the right passes. Since it is not part of the original object, it will be retained as part of the outline, which is what we expect from pixels next to the object. What is clever about the algorithm is how the mapping is represented. It is represented as a texture. In the red and green channels, we put the value of the map of that pixel. So in our example, we will have a texture that is all the same color. A dark yellow that represents the coordinate 0.5, 0.5. If we had two pixels in our object, the mapping would be a bit more interesting. Pixels on the left and in the vertical center will map to the center pixel, while the other pixels will map to the pixel next to it. So this time, the mapping will have two colors, the dark yellow that represents 0.5, 0.5, and a dark orange that represents the other pixel. For a width of 0, only the two pixels inside the object will pass. For a width of 0.25, our texel size, the pixels around them will pass too. Now, let's see how to construct the texture that represents the mapping for our one pixel object. The first step is to render the pixels of our object that we want to outline, using white on a black background. This will later be used as a mask to discard pixels in the original object. Next, we render the pixel coordinates of all the pixels in our object. We use pure blue to represent pixels that are not part of the object. Now, we will propagate information in a series of steps. For each pixel, we consider 9 pixels in a 3x3 grid, displaced by a certain distance around the current pixel. This is the jump distance that gives the algorithm its name. We start with a power of 2 for the jump distance, halving it in each step until it reaches 1 in the final step. The starting jump distance corresponds to the maximum width of the outline. In our example, let's start with a jump distance of 2. When we look at the top left pixel, this 3x3 grid looks like this. Part of it falls outside the image. These we ignore. 3 of the 4 pixels inside the image are blue. We ignore these two. Since there is only one non-blue pixel, we take this as the current pixel color. If we look at the pixel next to it, we see all the grid pixels are blue, so this pixel remains blue. Doing the same for all the pixels gives us this pattern. In the shader, this happens in parallel, so new colors don't affect other pixels until the next step. For the next step, we decrease the jump distance to 1, so this is also the last step. When we examine the top left pixel, only one pixel is not blue. This becomes the new color. When we examine the pixel next to it, there are two that are not blue, but they're both the same, so this becomes the color of our pixel. Doing this for all the pixels gives us the final mapping. The entire texture is now the same color. To see what happens when the pixels are not all the same, let's look at the example where our object has two pixels. We render the black and white mask, and then the UVs as red-green colors as before. We start with a jump distance of 2. When we look at the top left pixel, as before, only one pixel is not blue, so this color becomes the output color. The pixel next to it gets a color too, the color of the other pixel in our object. Doing this check for all pixels gives us this result. Next, we set the jump distance to 1. As before, we ignore blue pixels. But now, we have different non-blue pixels to choose from. Remember, these colors represent coordinates of pixels in our object, and for each pixel, we want the closest coordinate. If the pixel we are examining is P, and one of the pixels in the grid is Q, we calculate the length between P and the color of Q, and choose the color of the one with the lowest value. For the top left pixel, the non-blue pixels give us these distances. So here, the yellow pixel is closest, so it becomes the new color. For the top right pixel, we have these distances. So, for it, the output pixel is orange. If we do the same for all the pixels, this is the result, the texture we expect. Here's how the four stages look in a realistic situation. Notice that the color differences are quite subtle for pixels that are close to each other. Let's wrap up with some crucial implementation advice that can save you hours of frustration. Tip 1. Start early. Most of these algorithms don't work perfectly out of the box with arbitrary models. They often show artifacts. So the earlier in your game development that you implement your outline system, the easier it will be to ensure that all your art assets work well with it. Don't wait until the end. It's much harder to retrofit outlines onto existing art. Almost no technique will work completely without additional work. You may need to change art, tweak parameters, or perform some intermediate operations. Tip 2. Build test scenes. Once you have your outline style implemented, you'll need to carefully craft a test scene or a test tool that enables artists to easily see what the effect will look like with their art, so they can address any issues early on. Make sure the scale, viewing conditions, and effect settings match those of the game. Work with a simple test scene that makes it easy to see specific issues that may arise. Here is what to include at the very least. A sphere to test smooth surface handling. Both closed and open cubes to test hard edges and flat surfaces. A torus to check how it handles objects with holes. A long narrow cone to see how the algorithm handles sharp edges. A quad to test how the algorithm works with one-sided objects. A complex object, ideally a character from the game if one is available, or something of comparable complexity. And objects with fine features such as leafy trees or shrubs, if your game includes them. You'd also want a test scene that matches the typical complexity level of your game. This helps catch performance issues earlier as well. Tip 3. Debug like a pro. Create shader variants that visualize each type of discontinuity or edge that you are detecting. You can either use replace shaders or have a custom script replace materials for debugging purposes. For any technique we described in this video, it is useful to let shaders and post-process scripts display the different steps of the algorithm. In fact, this is a helpful tip to remember for general algorithm and shader development. Tip 4. Optimize smartly. If you use buffers or render textures, you can often get away with using a lower resolution, which can give you a decent performance boost. Tip 5. Beware of sampling issues and anti-aliasing. Anti-aliasing, downsampling of render buffers, and whether shadows are hard or soft can affect the quality of your edges. So test your algorithms with different settings of these. Rendering outlines is a tricky technique, but I hope I've given you a good starting point to understand the basic concepts. If you experiment with any of these ideas, rim shaders, vertex extrusion, or edge detection, please share your results in the comments. I'll put links in the description to example code and other resources you can investigate. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you want more deep dives into technical and artistic game effects. Thanks for watching. I'm Arman for GameLogic FX. Happy outlining.